Well, good morning, Waynesburg Bible Chapel. Happy Easter. He is risen. Hey, we'd like to invite you to stand and to sing as we celebrate. I was buried beneath my shame. Who could carry that kind of weight? It was my tomb till I met you. I was breathing but not
spoke your name into
celebrate the resurrection of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. You are the God who saves. You are the God who loves us, that you would love us so much that you would send Jesus to come and to die for sinners like us. And even though we don't understand why, you do. You love us because you love us. And instead of trying to spend our life figuring out the why you would do that, we want to come here and humbly, joyfully accept it and celebrate that what separates from any other belief, any other religion, any other little g God is that our God did what he said he was going to do. He rose again. We worship you, King Jesus, this morning. Not only do we celebrate just today to recognize your resurrection, every day is Easter. We love you and we praise you this morning, for it's in Christ's name that we pray. Amen. If you guys would like to be seated.
Good morning. I have a really important announcement. If you are in Awana, you are to go to the foyer. If you are in Awana, you are to go to the foyer. I don't see anyone moving, but I gave the announcement. Oh, wait, there. All the ants are moving. I see the ants moving. Good morning and welcome to Resurrection Sunday. We are so glad to have you. Hey, I need to give a big thank you to all the people, first of all, who came to the sunrise breakfast and all the many hands that helped. Luke was an amazing egg stirrer, the Wise family. Tiffany, you know, Tiffany has a special gift. She quietly sneaks in and out being a little helper. So I appreciate that, as well as my family that came from their churches to help. I really appreciate that. But most of all, since I have the mic and I have the opportunity, I want to thank my best friend, Lloyd Lohr, who is a support and help and just constantly going with my crazy ideas. He says, okay. And so I am just so thankful that I found a godly man who is willing to ride this life with me. So thank you, Mr. Lohr. Okay, this is also an important interactive announcement. I have two repeated announcements. That means I've already given these announcements. The children are gone. If you gave the announcements, this does not count. You cannot, if you know the amount, Ed, you are not allowed to answer these questions. We have two repeated announcements. I have two happy little surprises. Set them down since they took the podium away from me. All right, the first one. Does anyone know what's happening April 19th? April 19th. Ring any bell. I will be sleeping. You will be here. Okay, come on, Carly. She's so cute. Come on, Carly. Come on down. I know she's going to get this right. Come on, Carly. April 19th.
It's the secret church for the Book of Ruth.
That's right, the Book of Ruth. And guess what today is? The last day they can sign up. Correct. Sign up over there. It is the last. Congratulations. Okay, this is a big one. Don't everybody jump out of their seats. What happens April 20th right here at the Waynesburg Bible Chapel? Luke, come on. Oh, come on, Luke. Yeah. Okay, oh, you get to come forward. Do you want to come forward? Come on, Dad will go. Dad will go with you. Will your brother come? Oh, there we go. There we go. Come on. I love it. I love it. I love it. Yeah. Okay. All right. Can you tell Miss Bonnie what are we doing that day?
It's going to be spring cleaning.
Absolutely. Spring cleaning. Thank you. You did a great job. April 20th, we have spring cleaning. Guess what? You don't have to sign up for that. We just want you all to come. Please come. Many hands make
light work.
I may have said that. Okay, but we do have a couple of new announcements. The National Day of Prayer is May 2nd. There is a country breakfast at the fairgrounds. So that is May 2nd. I'm sure there'll be more information to come, but that is the one. And the second one would be CBM Camp does a yearly memorial breakfast. It's called the John Humble Memorial Breakfast. It is April 13th. We had more than pancakes, so FYI. Can you smell the bacon? So that is April 13th. It's from 8 a.m. to noon, and it's a donation-based, and it's at the CBM camp. For those of you that don't know where that is, I will have a flyer with the address that's on my phone that's not with me. But yeah, so if you have time and you would like to do that. Sue, we're going to hear from you in a minute, but it is time to pass off the mic. Ed, I have no prizes for you. Yours was the sausage.
Yeah. Now, thank you so much for those of you that have participated and helped out with the breakfast this morning. It was a real blessing, and it was a good time of fellowship. Yeah, my daughter's giving them a round of applause. Give them a round of applause if you showed up. It was delicious. So thank you so much for doing that. Just two things that I wanted to make sure that we are aware of here in the Waynesburg Bible Chapel. First, if you see people with an orange lanyard on, it actually means something. And I know it's the slides go up there that show you stuff, but I also know that we don't all read it. And so if you see somebody with one of these, look, we are broken people. Let's not act like we have it all together. Let's not act like we are, you know, we're perfect. Church is not that. We're broken people and we come together. And so these are for people, these lanyards are people that are willing to pray with you with what you're going through. We're all going through stuff. We all got stuff going on. And they're here to pray with you. So reach out to them, or they may reach out to you. So I just wanted to point that out. Secondly, over the last sort of 5 months, we've done a shift in the Waynesburg Bible Chapel to most of our small groups are meeting here on Wednesday nights to go along with our desire for discipleship pathways, and so that we have something for every man, woman, and child happening here on a Wednesday night. However, I'm going to announce this now so that everybody is aware. If you have the heart or desire to start a small group, you do not need to do it on a Wednesday night. You can pick another night of the week, and you are more than welcome to do a small group. Come talk to Jay and I. We have just some things that we probably would want to chat with you about. But feel that just because we moved to a Wednesday night does not mean we are locked in on a Wednesday night. This is the only night for small groups, because there actually is another small group that meets on a Thursday night. And so I just wanted to announce that real quick to make sure that everybody was aware of what we're doing and how we're doing it, because I understand. Sometimes that doesn't always get out there. So that's just it. Now I'm going to invite the kids up, because we're going to do kids first and then Sue. She's coming up. Don't worry. So the kids are going to come up. They got a quick little song, and then we're going to do something with Sue and enjoy.
Now stop.
Thank you.
If you ever wonder what we're up to downstairs during Awana, that's part of it. We sing songs and we praise the Lord together. Now we're going to do the thing with soup. Yeah. Come on up, Jay. Oh, okay. She's talking. Yes. All right.
Okay, everybody. Some of you have been asking a lot, what's going on in Haiti now? You've heard the news that it is a total disaster. Chaos is reigning in the south and it is spreading to the north. What I've heard is about 80% of the capital of Port-au-Prince has now been taken over by the gangs. So the people living there, having normal lives, their problem is how to get out of what is going on. If they go to work in the morning and they come home or they go to school, there could be a gang set up in their house and they can get nothing out of it. So we have refugees that are going to the north. They'll just take their family and head up to somebody in the north that might take them in. And that's what's happening with the Christians in the north. You know, in Haiti, it's a fifth world country. And there are just starving people all the time. They can barely get one meal a day. And yet if somebody comes to a Christian's home or a pastor's home, they'll take them in. They will have people sleeping on the floor if they have to. And I've even heard of them taking shifts sleeping. People have to go outside and walk the street so others can rest. So when you pray, pray for those Christians in the north that are giving what they have. I know of the pastor of our mission. He gets one meal prepared for him a day, rice and beans. And he has floor-to-floor people. And he spreads that meal out so everybody gets a few bites. I'm continuing with my mission of sending food into Haiti as much as I can. As long as the airplanes are flying into Cap Haitian, I can do this. So pray for me as I'm leaving. I'm still going to continue my mission to Haiti and pray for those people down there that are just wondering what to do. Where is my next meal coming from? How can I make it go far enough?
Don't run off here. And I've had the pleasure of knowing Sue and her family for years. we're not going to disclose that number. Yeah, a lot. And so her and her late husband Paul served both in St. Croix and in Haiti for a long time. And their heart is for other people and for missions. Sue's going to be moving now to be closer to her son, Pete, who's living in Montana. We're all jealous that she's going to Montana and we're not. So now you have a place to go visit. She's got a 2-bedroom, so just let her know ahead of time. Three. Wow. Okay. So anyway, we want to send her off. I'm going to ask the deacons if they would come up with us this morning. We're going to lay hands on Sue and just ask the Lord's blessings as she heads off to do some the same stuff in a different place. And so if you would stand with me and join as we pray for Sue as she's heading off here. Father God, we are so thankful for the opportunity to have been blessed by and to be around the Parsons family. They are truly committed to the Lord and have loved and served you in so many different ways. And we pray that you would continue to bless Sue as she reaches out to Haiti and to the people that are there supporting the Christians who can support the others who are trying to see the gospel message spread in their country. Pray for peace there. We pray for health and help for those that are citizens that are caught up in this terrible conflict there. We pray also for Sue as she heads off to Montana to be closer to some of her family. We ask that you would give her journey's mercies, but more than that, as she roots herself in that area in Montana, that you would allow her to bloom as she has done here. We love her, and we pray that you would continue to bless and keep her in your will, and we ask it in Christ's name. Amen. All right, we're going to take just a couple of minutes to greet people. It's not going to be an extended greeting like we normally do, so don't go too far.
We'd actually...
Your love is high like the tide coming through me in.
Thank you, guys. Good morning. Good morning. Wake up. Good morning. It is Resurrection Day, and we are excited to be here and to be gathered together and to worship the Lord through song and through our time around the communion this morning. If you weren't there, we missed you there, but thank you for being here. It is Easter. It is Resurrection Day. It is the Christian Super Bowl. And in case you're wondering, we win. and I'm glad of that. And so this morning, as you on Sunday mornings, as you know, we've been taking a trek through 1 Kings, and we will continue to do that. But I don't want you to feel like, oh, somehow we're slighting Easter or Resurrection Day. That's not the case. Very clearly, in Luke chapter 24, Jesus said all this is about him. And so we'll find a way today maybe to show you how it all connects, hopefully. But this morning, we're going to continue in our series in 1 Kings and see what God will allow us to unfold there. Father, this morning we are grateful for your word. We ask that you would bless it, that each and every one here would hear it, and that it would go deeper than just hearing the word, but it would make us followers, obeyers, those who respond to the word. And so thank you for this privileged opportunity to gather around it, for we ask it in Christ's precious name. Amen. The section we're going to be handling this morning is 1 Kings 12, 25 through 13, 10. I have 60 slides. You're going to be late for lunch. No. We're going to try to make sure that doesn't happen. So in the previous few weeks, we've been talking about this idea of Solomon's life is coming to and has now come to an end. And there's this really rocky transition of getting the handoff to Rehoboam, his son. And really what's showing up, or what appears to be showing up as we've unfolded from some of the previous sermons, is that Solomon's sins are kind of catching up not only to him, but to his families and successors. And the result of that is there was a big divide in Israel, where the northern kingdom and the southern kingdom divided and split off. And that may have been avoided a little bit had they taken Brendan's message last week to heart that says, reject bad advice, refuse a wicked response, and respond to prophetic words. And so there was some messages for us in there, as I hope there will be for us today as we go through these verses. So here's kind of what the roadmap looks like a little bit today, is I want to kind of just walk through these verses and unpack just some thoughts that come out of this. And then I want to make three observations that really can be applicable to us as we think about how this unfolds here a little bit. And then I'd like to end with just a thought about, okay, so how does this relate to the resurrection? How are we going to tie this all together? And so that's kind of our path this morning. I'm going to read for us these verses. I'm going to kind of split it up. And so 1 Kings 12, 25 to 33, and says, and then Jeroboam built Shechem and in the mountains of Ephraim, and dwelt there. Also, he went out from there to build Penuel. And Jeroboam said in his heart, now the kingdom may return to the house of David, and if these people go offer sacrifices in the house of the Lord at Jerusalem, then their hearts of these people will turn back to their Lord, Rehoboam, king of Judah, and they will kill me and go back to Rehoboam, king of Judah. Therefore, the king asked advice. They made two calves of gold, and he said to the people, this is too much for you to go to Jerusalem. Here are your gods, O Israel, which brought you up from the land of Egypt. And he set one up in Bethel and put the other one in Dan. Now this thing became a sin for the people, went to worship before the one as far as Dan. And he made a shrine on the high places. He made priests from every class of people who were not the sons of Levi. Jeroboam ordained a feast on the 15th day of the eighth month, like the feast in Judah. He offered sacrifices on the altar. So he did at Bethel, sacrificing to the calves that he made. And at Bethel, he installed priests of the high places, which he had made. So he made offerings on the altar, which he had made at Bethel on the 15th day of the eighth month, in the month which he had devised in his own heart. And he ordained a feast for the children of Israel and offered sacrifices on the altar and burned incense. And so the first thing that I want us to notice here is that Jeroboam's on the move. He's moved from Jerusalem, which was the hub, which is where the temple was built, and he's going up to Shechem and up to Penuel, and he's starting to establish his kingdom up in the north in a place that where he was not called to do so. And so as we think about it, if you look at the map here, Jerusalem's down there with the green circle. He went all the way as far as Dan, where they would have a calf, and all the way as far as Bethel, so that they were conveniently located, according to him. And then he built Shechem and Penuel, where he would kind of set up his stuff to be happening there. And so what's happening is he's separating himself from Judah, and by virtue of doing so, he's separating himself from God and from God's people and God's plan and God's system of worship and the way that God and the temple held the altar of incense, the place where God's presence was, where the Levitical priests were supposed to be doing whatever they did. And all of that was a picture of Christ that was coming. And so he is now separating himself from the people of God. And he's done this, or it would appear as we've been unfolding some of these passages, that part of why he was doing this was because his father, Solomon, was running off the rails a little bit. He was taxing the people very heavily, and he was putting a lot of undue pressure on them. And so Rehoboam, his son, had the chance to say, okay, let's lighten this load, because it was never supposed to be this way. But he didn't do it. And so even in Jeroboam's idea of doing this, his righteous indignation has gone sideways. And it kind of speaks of us doing the right thing the wrong way. And so often we see this drift where we're kind of moving away from God, where we're moving away from God's people. And it's the first thing, quite frankly, that over the 40-plus years that I've been doing ministry, one of the first signs of seeing people drift away from the Lord is when they stop gathering with God's people. They kind of drift off and they start thinking we can do this on our own. And I would be the first one to tell you that you do not have to come to church to be a Christian. It's not part of the criteria. It's faith in Christ alone. That's all his finished work. But here's what I can tell you is you can't be a strong Christian and not come to church. And so you just get to choose which one you want to be. But the drift will happen. It will move away if we don't allow ourselves to see what God's doing here. This is not a perfect place. You will not find a perfect place, but it's what God has ordained that we should come together and be involved with. And so that's where we are supposed to be. And so be careful when you're trying to do the right thing, but you decide that there's a different way than God's way to do it. Because I can tell you that it says in 1 Corinthians that therefore let him who thinks he stand take heed lest he fall. And sometimes we think we're doing the right thing for the right reasons, but we're doing it the wrong way, and it can cause us to start moving and drifting away from God. The next thing that we see in Jeroboam's life here is that he has this self-talk going on, and it says, Jeroboam said in his heart. Jeroboam said in his heart. And there is a real problem with starting to tell yourself. Here's the three things he was saying to himself. The kingdom will return to the house of David. If they go to Jerusalem, they'll turn back to Rehoboam. They will kill me and go back to Rehoboam. Do you see it? You see a theme going on here? Look at the theme that's running through these verses. He is fixating on losing these people that he's garnered to himself. The people have almost become a god to him. They have validated his very existence. And so who he is was, I don't want him going back there. I don't want him going back. I don't want to lose my following. And it all started with his idea in his heart. And here's the problem with self-talk, is it's really hard to get it out of your head. You ever heard of the thing of something called an earworm? That's when you get a song in your head and you can't get rid of it. That's what self-talk starts to do. It starts to tell, you start telling yourself stories that aren't even true anymore. And they're usually rooted in fear versus fact. They're not rooted in the biblical truths. They're rooted in what I might lose or what I might not be able to get or what I might not be able to gain. And they begin to get louder and louder and louder. And they're often louder than truth in our own hearts and in our own minds. And they tend to seek what we want. They tend to validate ourselves versus what God has called for us and wants for us. And here's the really scary part. That we should, if you take nothing else from this sermon, from these passages, is unknowingly we influence others by our drifting. Mothers and fathers, you'll influence your children. Grandparents, you'll influence your grandchildren. Aunts and uncles, you will have an influence on somebody else. And there is a theme that's repeated. When you see the split in the kingdom, the southern kingdom was Judah and Benjamin, and the northern kingdom was the rest of Israel, and not one righteous king is found in the northern kingdom. And here's the phrase that continues through these books. And he did what was evil in the eyes of the Lord and walked in the ways of who? Jeroboam. This whole thing is laid at his feet. For generations, for years to come, they walked in the sins and the ways of Jeroboam, and he caused Israel to commit them. And we are all accountable for ourselves. We are all accountable for the things that we do, but we are also held accountable for the things that we influence other people to do and the ways that we have an impact in somebody else's life. And so be careful how we walk and be careful first how we talk, because this all started because he said in his heart, because he decided something in his heart. The next thing we see is this idea of kind of doing or saying anything to get what we want. It's that self-motivation. It's that like justification and rationalization. And that's what he was using convenience. It's too far for you to go to Jerusalem. You don't want to do that. It's so much more pragmatic for you to be here. It's very practical. This is the way. And those are not good gods. Convenience and pragmatism are not good gods. They're unrighteous gods. They tend to serve ourselves and get us what we want and not what God wants. And rationalizing and justification are just ways to comfort our own sin. Just tell ourselves, it'll just be okay. It's not that bad. It's not something, you know, I mean, what difference does it make? It's just a few miles north of here, is what he was telling himself. Too hard for you to go down there. And what we forget is God is way more interested in our holiness than he is our happiness. He's way more interested in us following what he tells us to do. He made us. He designed us. He's not the God up there with a big stick hitting you when you're doing because he wants to see you suffer or torment. He made you, and he made you in his very own image. He knows you and what you need and what you don't need. And when we depart from his word, we begin to look for our own happiness instead of his holiness. And guess what they do? The same old, same old. Now, what does it say? He made two calves and said, this is the God who brought you out of Egypt. Does that sound familiar to anybody? It's the most cliche thing they could have done. Aaron did the exact same thing when they were coming out of the nation of Israel. And Aaron, he had a little bit more innovation in his. Because when Moses challenged him, he said, all I did was I took the golden threw it in the fire and this came out. Does that sound like something we'd say? Or does it sound like something a four-year-old would say to his parents? And we're no different. All of a sudden, these calves are who brought them out of Israel, or brought them out of Egypt. And you had a compromised king who is ruling a complacent people who just let them guide him anywhere he wanted to go. And here's what I have to say to you, that corruption from a leadership does not excuse you. And if you see the leadership of this church heading off in another direction or following a different gospel, you do not follow. You do not follow. That's your obligation, your responsibility. It's one of the reasons we believe in an elder rule here, so we can hold each other accountable, so we can be talking to each other and challenging each other. And there's a godly model that's been shared in the next few weeks we'll be talking to you about, of how God has created elders here so that we shepherd together to keep us from that, because we are not going to be as much as possible within us leading you off into a direction where God would not have you to go, because we're trying to stick close to his word. But you are not excused because of a bad leader. Because here's the problem. Once you start, how do you stop? One sin will lead you to another sin. It's like lying. You tell one lie, you have to tell another one to cover up that lie and another one to cover up that lie, and it just starts growing. And it's the thing your parents taught you when you were yay high about any kind of sin in your life. It just starts compounding. And all of a sudden, not only does he have these calves that are set up here, he set up priests that are not from the tribe of Levi. He's burning altars, incense and fires on the altars. His sin is multiplying in Israel because he just started in one place and then started headed off. And once you start headed off, our integrity and the fall of our integrity is like dominoes. Once you hit one, it just starts building one right after the other, one right after the other. Because let's face it, if I can take any of these verses, and certainly there are some verses in here that are not meant literally, that are certainly figuratively, but once I start taking a verse and just excusing it, I can do it with any of them. We saw that happening back in the 70s when I was younger. It's like God says marriage is the way that he wanted things to go, and then people just started living together and saying, it's okay, it's okay, it's okay. And now we'll look where we are. Just one sin right after another. And if you are here and not married and living with somebody, let us teach you how God's word can put you in a right relationship. This is not judgment. This is not condemnation. This is not me beating you with a stick. This is me saying, this is what God said is best for you. This is God's plan for you. And do what God says, that if we do what God says, he will add a blessing. He will add a blessing the way he chooses to bless. And so once you start, it's really hard to stop. In fact, James tells us that each one is tempted when he is drawn away by his own desire and then enticed. And then when his desire is conceived, it gives birth to sin. And sin, when it is full grown, brings forth death. Do not be deceived, my beloved brethren. Do not be deceived. There is a progression to sin, and God wants us to avoid it. And the problem that all sin that kind of starts to depart is it's never once do you say, hey, somebody come in and say, come on in, we're going to drink Kool-Aid and kill ourselves. That's not where it starts. It never starts there. It starts with something that kind of looks like it. And what Jeroboam did was he started these feasts and these sacrifices that were just like the ones that were in Judah. So it kind of had the feel like it was good, like it was okay. But departing from the truth often happens with these just little steps, these little incremental steps, just one step at a time, and we rationalize and we justify and we mix just enough truth with it so it doesn't stink as bad as it really does. We put just enough spin on it to make it sound like it might be something close to what God wants us to do. God wants us to follow his word. not follow our version. And this whole idea of your truth versus my truth is not truth. It's untruth. 2 plus 2 is always 4, right? Not if you feel like it's 5. I get it. Those are facts, not truth. But the point is that God's truth is always truth. And there isn't one version that we get to make up that makes us feel better. Because when we make the move that Jeroboam is making here, it's going to be subtle. When somebody's trying to lead us away, it's going to be just enough truth to get us looking in a different direction than where God wants us to be. We move on then to 1 Kings 13. And it says, "Behold, a man of God went from Judea to Bethel by the word of the Lord, and Jeroboam stood by the altar to burn incense. And then he cried out against the altar by the word of the Lord and said, 'O altar, altar, thus says the Lord, behold, a child, Josiah by name, shall be born to the house of David, and on you he shall sacrifice the priest of the high places who burn incense on you, and the men's bones shall be burned on you.' And he gave us a sign the same day, saying, 'This is the sign which the Lord has spoken. Surely the altar will be split apart, and the ashes on it will be poured out. For it came to pass when King Jeroboam heard the saying of the man of God who cried out against the altar in Bethel, that he stretched out his hand from the altar, saying, "Arrest him." And then his hand, which he stretched out toward him, withered, so he could not pull it back to himself. And the altar also split apart, and the ashes poured out from the altar, according to the sign of the man of God who had given by the word of the Lord. And then the king answered and said to the man of God, "Please entreat the favor of the Lord your God and pray for me that my hand should be restored to me." So the man of God entreated the Lord, and the king's hand was restored to him and became as before. Then the king said to the man of God, "Come to my home and with me and refresh yourself, and I will give you a reward." But the man of God said to the king, "If you were to give me half of your house, I would not go with you. Nor would I eat the bread or wine in your place. For so it was commanded to me by the word of the Lord, saying, 'You shall not eat bread, you shall not drink water, nor return by the same way you came.' So he went another way and did not return by the way he came to Bethel." And so we see here that all of a sudden, Amog shows up. You know what Amog is? That's a man of God. Mogs and wogs. That's what God's looking for. And what's exciting about this is it's not really about the man. It's about the message. It's never been about the man. That's what we like to do. We like to make it about the man, right? We like to follow the big name. We like to follow the one that, you know, itches our tickle or tickles our itching ears. We like to follow people. We like to put people up. All they are is just a representative of God. Nobody special. Nobody special. We don't even know what this guy's name is. And some of the greatest things that God did and the times he visited with people. Tell me the name of the boy who had 2 loaves and 2 fishes. What was his name? There were 2 on the road to Emmaus. We know Cephas was one of them. Who's the other one? We don't know. God often shows up and does things through people, and it's not about the people. It's about God. It's about him making his presence known, and he always has somebody to show up. He always has somebody that will speak a word. He has a remnant. In the days of Elijah, there was a remnant of people that were just holding on to God's word. When it looked like everybody had gone astray, God always has somebody to show up. So my question for you, Mogs and Wogs, is if God has somebody who's going to show up, who do you want that to be? Do you want him showing up for you, or do you want it to be you showing up? Because God wants to use us. God wants to speak through us. God wants us to share his message. We're just a little afraid of our culture, aren't we? That's the problem. We're just a little afraid to say, I disagree with that. But he is us to show up, his mogs, his wogs, who are going to show up and speak his message and his truth into this culture. And we can't, I'm not saying to be abrasive. I'm not saying to be, you know, like ignorant or bring reproach. I'm just saying speak truth, lovingly speak truth. Here's what's interesting. As I read this a couple times through, I'm like going, oh, wait a minute. He didn't talk to Jeroboam. He talked to the altar. He prophesied to the altar. And he's prophesying here to an inanimate object. And you know what that does for me? It says if an inanimate object obeys God and it's more obedient than we are, what does that say about us? We've been given this wonderful opportunity, and the altar did exactly what he said. What do you do? What do I do? When God says to do. And we are left with this decision of who are we going to find. God will find a way to accomplish his plan, his purpose. He delights in using us. But when Jesus came in, he said, if they don't do it, the rocks will. I'll find somebody. Because God will accomplish what he is ready to accomplish and what he has ordained to accomplish. And he is not confined as we are, in the same way that we are. He will accomplish what he is ready to accomplish. And yep, he's yelling for human sacrifices here. Now that seems a little strange, doesn't it? A God who is not for that at all is saying, there's going to be sacrificed. A child by the name of Josiah is going to sacrifice on you, O altar. And sometimes God gives us just exactly what we're asking for. Sometimes God uses these extreme things to show us how ridiculous our sin is, how grievous our sin is. And sometimes in this situation, he used something defiled to reflect their defilement. You're going to defile, let me show you defilement. Guess what? 300 years later, a king comes into to reign in the southern kingdom. His name is Josiah. Just so happened it was Josiah. And it just so happens he was 8 years old when he became king. Not a normal thing. And it just so happens that he exactly fulfilled this prophecy that was made. Because God will accomplish his work, his way, and his will. And he gave him a sign. Now, God only gives a sign when he deems it necessary. Signs were given for God to affirm. And we saw this all through the history of the Bible. When God was doing great and wondrous and starting something new, he would often use signs and miracles to validate and to show. But those are not the thing that God wants us to have a steady diet of. Those are not the things that show up every day in our lives, because guess what we would do? We'd start worshiping and we'd start demanding and we'd start worshiping the signs, not the sign giver. We would start looking to those things for our needs and our comforts. We are called to live by faith. That's the calling. It's a privilege for us to get to do it. It frustrates me sometimes, I'll be honest with you. So I'm not sitting here telling you that I love the fact that God doesn't show up, but God has shown up in very miraculous ways in my life in the past. And so he is still doing that. It's just maybe sometimes we're not watching close enough for it. And sometimes when he does do it, what are we doing with that information? What are we doing with that? It was very clearly the way he showed up in my life when I came to him. Through the windshield of a car, that's pretty, took a lot for me. But he opened my eyes. And so requesting a sign from God is not what he demands. In fact, here's what Jesus said. A wicked and adulterous generation seeks after a sign. No sign will be given to it except the sign of the prophet Jonah. God wants a relationship with you, not with his tricks, not with his abilities and skills. He wants a relationship with us individually. And we talk about Gideon who asked for the fleece. That was sin. God told Gideon what he was going to do, and Gideon said, And yes, did he do make the fleece wet? Yeah, he did. But that wasn't what God, you know what God wants? It says, and then God said to Abraham, go to a land that I will show you. What, you know what the next verse says? And Abraham went. That's what God wants. Not looking for a sign. Not looking for tricks and dog and pony show to get us to obey. He wants us to have such a relationship with him that when he tells us, it makes natural sense for us to follow him. You know what he said? Jeroboam said, arrest him. And it was almost comical. Because Jeroboam's like going, hey, arrest him. And guess what? He didn't have any real power. Guess what? Our kings don't either. God chose in that moment to protect the man of God. And when and how he does it, it's his choice. But why doesn't he always do that? You know, don't you like the movie when it just like the good guy sweeps in, the cavalry comes, they win the what? We love those kind of movies. Sometimes God does that, sometimes he doesn't, but it's his choice. And I'll tell you, if we go through the book of Hebrews, the great faith chapter, and there's all these things that God did, you could see where he was stopping the mouths of lions and quenching violent fires and valiant in battles, and he turned armies and he gave dead back. But guess what the rest of that verse says? Others were tortured. Others were tortured. But guess what it says? That they might obtain a better resurrection. There were all these things that happened. Sometimes God shows up. Sometimes it seems like he doesn't show up, but he's there, right in the middle of it with us. Sometimes it's for us. Sometimes it's for a future reward. We have no idea. But don't think that somehow God's your sugar daddy and you get to tell him what to do and how to do it. He shows up when he shows up. And he does exactly what he said here. His arm was withered, and he gets Jeroboam's attention. And then God provides an immediate response there, but a partial fulfillment, because 300 years later is when the rest of that's coming. And it doesn't always happen right in that moment, but the power is in the word of the Lord. When it's spoken, it doesn't matter. Jesus said 2,000 years ago, he's coming back. We talked about that in the early service. Guess what? He's coming back. No reason to doubt it. And then there's this incredulous statement that he makes. He says, oh, by the way, can you heal me? The guy he was just going to seize and arrest and probably end up torturing and killing. And he said, will you heal me? I mean, that's gutsy. That takes a lot of nerve to say, hey, I was going to arrest you, but hey, fix me after God. And so he does it. And it seems like the world wants to deny the power of God right up until the point where they need it. Go back a few years to 9/11. Oh, everybody was talking about prayer then. Didn't matter if you were a Christian or not. You couldn't say a word about prayer before, but now everybody's like, yeah, pray, please pray. Right when we need it. That's how we respond. And God responds, but not like us. Because sometimes we want to go, no. And at the very end, Jeroboam says, come on home with me, because he wants to commercialize God's power. Same thing happened in the book of Acts with Simon, who had the spirit, saw Paul drive out the spirit, and he says, hey, can I buy that off of you? That's what he was trying to do here, trying to get something. And he uses this term. He said, even if you gave me half of your house, that was an expression. You saw it in the book of Esther. You saw it different places where they said, hey, whatever you want. That was just a way of you know, expressing their satisfaction of saying, whatever you want, up to half your house. He's saying it the backwards. He said, even if you gave me half of your household, I wouldn't take it. Because he had that, you remember the old hymn, take the world, but give me Jesus. And that's really the attitude that he was taking there Maybe Jesus wasn't in his mind at that point, but he was following after the word of God. So three things as we close here, because I know we're in a little bit of overtime here. Be wary of the move. It's very subtle. It's very slow. It's very easily undetected in our lives. Be wary of the fact that we are all prone to wander. Lord, I feel it. Prone to leave the God I love. Keep your eyes on that. Beware of the Mogs and Wogs. God's got them around us. They speak truth in our life. They speak truth in situations where we're not expecting it sometimes. Be the Mog. Be the Wog. Don't be the one he needs to go send to get you back in line. And be open to God's methods, because he works in ways that are just not like ours. They're just different than ours. As the band comes up, I just want to say, all right, how do we connect this to Easter? And so when you think about all the things that were just happening, guess what? We were all on the move, all of us. All of us were moving as quickly as we could away from God. And our self-talk had convinced us one of two things. You're either good enough or you're not good enough. And both of those are lies. You're good enough. You don't need this all this religion stuff. You're good enough. I mean, hey, you do more right than wrong. God does not have a scale. It's all based on Jesus Christ and the fact that one sin is enough to send you to hell. Just one. And our golden calves weren't like theirs, but they were just like theirs. It's stuff that we had set up in our lives to make us more comfortable, to make us more convenient, and to make us feel good about ourselves. But there is one way and only one way to salvation. And let's face it, our lives still have a lot of compromise and a lot of rationalization in them, but we had fixed ourselves in such a way that we were just okay. But you know what? God didn't send a Mog. He didn't send a man of God. He sent the God-man. 100% God, 100% man, that he could carry every one of our sins right to that cross, and from the cross right to the grave, and come out victorious. And he gave us a sign. Unto you a child is born. Unto you a son is given. And guess what? Not one thing we can do to pay for it. Just like that Jeroboam wanted to pay no. Not a thing that we have to give, because he's risen, just like he said. Just like he said. Thank you.
God, we are just so incredibly grateful that we can come here this morning, we can celebrate your holy name. Lord, when we just think about the cross, we think about the fact that our sins were taken. We were made separate and complete in you. Lord, we just thank you that 3 days after you died on that cross, that you rose again, you proved that you were God. There's nothing that we can do, Lord, and so we just lift all of it to you. Help us to remember that this week as we just go. Lord, allow us to be the gospel message in a culture that